Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to give you one more example of application of the conditioning techniques that we saw earlier. And more precisely, we are going to solve the following problem. Let's assume that a player plays alternatively with two opponents that we call opponents 1 and 2. We assume that the game is going to stop when this player is going to win twice in a row. And we also assume, in some sense, that opponent 1 is a stronger player in the sense that at each step of the game, our player is going to win against opponent 1 with probability P and against opponent 2 with probability Q, and we assume that P is less than Q, meaning that our player is less likely to win against opponent 1 than opponent 2. Now, a natural question is, with which opponent should our player start playing in order to win as fast as possible in average, meaning in order to minimize the expected number of games she will have to play. So, to solve this problem, I'm going to call phi of P, Q, the probability that our player is going, I mean, not the probability, but the expected number of games the player will have to play until winning twice in a row if she starts with opponent 1. So I'm going to write this quantity, so phi of PQ is going to be the expected value of, I'm going to write T for the total number of games she will have to play, so like T for time. And I'm going to put a 1 here to say that this is the expected number of games if she starts playing with opponent 1. Then I put a P here first because that's the probability that she wins against opponent 1, and Q is the probability of winning against opponent 2. Then we are going to also introduce another function phi QP that is just going to be the same expected number of games she will have to play, but when starting with opponent 2. So this is going to be expected value of T, but starting with opponent 2, and I remind you also that P is less than Q. So now the question is, given that, you know, we have P less than Q, now we want to compare those two quantities, and of course, if phi of PQ is strictly less than phi of QP, that would mean that it's better for our player to start playing against player 1. At the opposite, if this is strictly larger than that, then it's better to minimize the number of games she has to play to play against opponent 2 first. So, to compute, so first we are going to compute this quantity, and by symmetry that's going to be easy to deduce this one. So how can we compute this quantity here? So a natural way to do it is, of course, now we are going to solve the problem by doing conditioning. So a natural way to do it is to condition, and because she's going to play with opponent 1 and then 2 and then back to 1, that looks natural to kind of use a restart argument to condition on the outcomes of the first two games. So I'm going to write condition on partition, condition on the partition. So there are four possible outcomes for the first two games: win, 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 lose, lose, win, or lose, lose. And so this partition would become win, 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 lose, win, lose, lose, win, or lose, lose. Okay, so let's see if it's smart indeed or if we should change that. So given that our player is going to win twice in a row, that's clear that T is going to be equal to 2. So that the expected value of T given WW is easy. Now, what happens if we condition on WL? That means that our player is going to win the first game, but lose the second one. And because the game stops when she, if she wins twice in a row, you can here use some kind of restart argument again and just say that, well, after two games, she has to restart from scratch. And then that means that the expected value of t becomes 2, these first two games, plus again the expected value of t. Given that she starts with player 1, because at the third game she's going to play again with player 1. Now, we have trouble here at the opposite. If she loses twice in a row, we can use the same argument as here, use this restart argument, but if she loses first and then wins after, then after a win, we cannot really use a restart argument because she already has a win in her pocket. And then this event here breaks the symmetry. But we can easily solve the problem by basically collapsing those two events. So instead of using a partition with four members like that, I'm going to use only three events. Those first two ones, and the third event is going to be the union of those two. That's obviously still a partition. And now we are in a case which looks like the previous one. So I'm going to write this and then lose here. Okay, so indeed that's a partition of the sample space. And you see that if she loses the first game, we have no information about the second game. So after a loss, because again, the game stops when she wins twice in a row, after each loss, she has to restart, like start from scratch, and that's where we can use our restart argument. And indeed, if she loses the first game, we can easily compute the conditional expectation of t. But be careful, because here, she's losing the first game against player 1, against opponent 1, and then the second game will be played against opponent 2. So that means that the conditional expectation of the number of games, given that she loses the first game, is not going to be equal to 1 for this first game plus that. That's going to be 1 for this first game plus this quantity instead. Okay, because she's going to play against player 2, against opponent 2 at step 2. So that's kind of the idea of the proof. So let's write those equations in details. So what is this phi of PQ? So by using the conditioning that's equal to expected value starting with opponent 1 of t, given that she wins the first two games, times the probability that she wins the first two games, plus, and I'm not going to write all the details, but plus, well, the same term, but using this event instead, and then this event instead. So we have a sum of three terms, and we can compute those terms explicitly. So what is this expression here? So the expected value here is easy to compute. If she wins the first two games, then that's it. The game stops, she won twice in a row, and so that means that if she wins the first two games, then the total number of games is going to be equal to 2, so that's just 2. And probability of winning twice in a row, it's going to be probability of winning the first two games, it's probably of winning against opponent 1, then winning against opponent 2, that's going to be equal to p times q. So this first term is just equal to 2pq. Then the one with a WL is going to be a little bit more tricky. So in this case, the probability of winning and then losing, if she starts with opponent 1, is going to be winning against 1, it's probability p. Losing against 2, that's probability 1 minus q. So here, probability here, if we have a WL instead, that's going to be p times 1 minus q. P times 1 minus q. And then the conditional expectation here, so maybe I should erase that so that we understand better. So now we are looking at this term WL. And In this case, so this probability is p times 1 minus q, then this expected value becomes 2 for those two games that were already played, plus now she's going after that to play the third game against opponent 1, so that's going to be a 2 plus again expected value of t given that she starts with opponent 1, so that's 2 plus this quantity here. So we have 2 plus phi of pq. And then for the third term, again, so that we see what's going on, I'm going to erase here. And now we look at the conditional expectation given that she loses the first game. So in this case, p of losing, given that, like, in the context where she starts with player 1, is just going to be 1 minus p. She's winning against player 1 with probability p, so she's losing with probability 1 minus p. So we have a plus 1 minus p here. And then this conditional expectation becomes, so 1 for this game that she already played. So given that she loses the first game, in average, she will have to play one game, this first game that is lost, plus, now we can restart again, like she has to start from scratch, but now at second game, she's going to play against opponent 2. So this conditional expectation is not 1 plus this quantity, it's going to be 1 plus phi of qp instead of phi q, okay? So here we have 1 plus phi of qp. Okay, so we have this expression. So now we are done with the probability part, and the rest of the proof is just about doing some algebra. Now we have a relationship between phi of pq and phi of qp. We know also that we don't need to do the calculation by symmetry, phi of qp should be equal to also this expression by symmetry, phi of qp is equal to that, but this expression obtained by exchanging the role of p and q. So we are going to use this expression and this kind of symmetry to estimate, so a natural quantity to look at, because we want to compare those two quantities and see which one is the largest. It's to look at the quantity phi of pq minus phi of qp. I'm going to call this A, for instance. So let's call A the difference, phi of pq minus phi of qp. And so what about this quantity? Okay, so first, this one starts with a 2pq. By symmetry, this one is going to start with a 2qp. Pq is equal to qp, so we don't really need to care about this term. It's going to disappear in the difference. So, maybe first, let's look at the constant term. What I mean by constant term, it's like the term that only depends on p and q and not on this expected value of phi of pq or phi of qp. So here we are going to have a, I'm going to compute this term here. So from this one, we are going to have 2p times 1 minus q, 2p times 1 minus q. Then by symmetry, we should have a minus 2q times 1 minus p, coming from this term with the minus, but obtained by exchanging the role of p and q here. So that the term coming from these two here that corresponds to restarting after two games. Now there is also this 1 times 1 minus p coming from this event where she's losing her first game, and so that's one game lost and then you restart after. So eventually you still have a plus 1 minus p, but again by symmetry we should have a minus 1 minus q coming from when the analog term but obtained by changing p and q for this term here. So now we have some simplification. You see here, we have 2pq here minus 2pq, but here minus 2q times minus p. So you have a 2pq minus 2pq, so we can ignore those two ones. Here, of course, we can get rid of the ones. And so eventually what we get is exactly 2p minus 2q minus p. So 2p minus p is equal to p. And again, by symmetry, minus 2q plus q, that's a minus q. So eventually, if you ignore those two terms here, what you obtain for what I want to call the constant term is exactly a p minus q. So this is equal to p minus q. Now we still need to do some work to see what happens for the other terms. So now for the other terms, we are going to have plus p times 1 minus q times this. So plus p times 1 minus q times phi of pq. Now I'm going to continue dealing with the phi of pq. So, or maybe I'll do that after. It's going to become messy. So, then we have this. Then we also have this plus 1 minus p times phi of qp. So, plus 1 minus p times phi of qp. And again, coming, so that comes from this term here. Then also coming from this term, we have, well, the same expression, but just with a minus in front instead of a plus, and obtained by exchanging the role of p and q. So that's going to give us a minus, if I rewrite this one, minus q times 1 minus p times phi of qp. And then coming, like, similar to this one, we have a minus 1 minus q times phi of pq. So you see, to get this expression, so we use conditioning here, like a little bit in the same spirit as in the previous one, but here we use a lot of this kind of symmetry where we use that phi of qp should be equal to the same expression as what we found for phi of pq, but exchanging the role of p and q. So doing this, you kind of save time. And so we obtain this expression. It's still a little bit messy, but we can simplify this much more. So now we have that A. I'm going to recall the definition of A. So we have that this term A, which is phi of pq minus phi of qp, so is equal to this p minus q. So maybe I can write here, so p minus q. And so let's look at the term in, so you see here you have phi of pq here and here, and phi of qp here and there, so you have it here and here. And so let's see what's in front of that. We have a p times 1 minus q minus 1 minus q, so that's like a plus p minus 1 minus p minus 1 times 1 minus q. I'm going to write a minus instead, because I don't like the p minus 1. P minus 1 is negative. I prefer to keep the 1 minus p. So you see, focusing only on this one expression here, we have p minus 1 times 1 minus q. You can put 1 minus q in factor. So p minus 1 times 1 minus q, I'm going to say that it's a minus 1 minus p times 1 minus q. So we have minus 1 minus p times 1 minus q times phi of pq. And normally, by symmetry, we should also find a minus 1 minus q times 1 minus p, or not a minus, but a plus 1 minus Q times 1 minus P times phi of QP obtained by exchanging the role of P and Q, again by symmetry. Indeed, that's the case. Let's check that. Now, if we look at the blue terms here, that's the coefficient in front of phi of QP, you see that we have a 1 minus P again, and in front of that, a 1 times 1 minus P here, minus Q times 1 minus P, that's a plus 1 minus Q times 1 minus P. Okay, so we have here a plus 1 minus Q times 1 minus P, and this times phi of QP this time. Okay, and so now we are almost done. Obviously, 1 minus P times 1 minus Q is equal to 1 minus Q times 1 minus P, so we can simplify this even more. And eventually, we are going to get, so this is equal to P minus Q minus 1 minus P times 1 minus Q times this phi of PQ, and then minus here this phi of QP. Okay, and here you recognize exactly A. Okay, that's what we call A at first. That's this difference that appears here again. So I'm not going to write more equation, I'm just going to replace this by A. And so eventually, we conclude that for this defining A that way, we obtain that 1 plus 1 minus P times 1 minus Q times A is equal to P minus Q. So now let's go back to, so now we are done with the algebra. Now that's just a silly reasoning to conclude. We know that P is less than Q, meaning that opponent 1 is the stronger opponent, let's say, because the probability that our player wins against player against opponent 1 is going to be smaller. So opponent 1 is the strong opponent, let's say. And so under this condition, we have P minus Q negative. So this is negative. And well, clearly, 1 minus P is between 0 and 1, same for this one. So this product here is positive, plus 1 is still positive. So that means from all this reasoning, we deduce that if P is less than Q, then A should be negative. A should be negative. And so that means that, going back here, I'm going to keep this expression here, but so going back here, we deduce that this is A, that's negative. And so that means that we said this is negative, okay? And so that means that this is less than that, okay? So eventually, this means that the expected value, going back to the definition here, that means that the expected number of games starting with player 1 is going to be strictly less than the expected number of games starting with against player 2. And so that means that to minimize the expected number of games this player or player will have to play, she should start with, so that one is smaller, so she should start with player 1.